Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, 1943 at Warner Brothers. We've got a pretty outstanding anti-fascist double feature for you, some very contentious material to deal with, and I'm expecting an interesting discussion. Before we get into Mission to Moscow and Edge of Darkness, let's take a look at Joel W. Findler's chart of stars at Warner Brothers during this calendar year of 1943. As always, we present this with the proviso that the 1, 2, or 3 star ratings appended to each person's name. The decision here is purely Findler's from The Hollywood Story. We don't always know exactly why he made these choices. We can conjecture, but that's all. He even leaves some people out that baffle me at times. But let's go ahead and hear who's on the list for 1943. Ida Lupino, 2 stars. Paul Hunreed, 2 stars. Betty Davis, 3 stars. Peter Lorre, 1 star.
Unfair.
In terms of Findler's stated mission of discussing what kind of clout this person would have had at the time at the top of a cast list, and Peter Lorre, by 1943, is more valuable, I think, as a supporting player. Yeah. Although I love movies that he stars in.
That should be taken into account. The supporting players are valuable, indeed, to great filmmaking.
I quite agree. Usually they're not even on this list, and the only reason he and the next person, Sidney Greenstreet, are on there is because they actually led certain casts as well. Like Three Strangers, one of my very favorite movies. The Verdict is also a team up with those two. You know, someone like Frank Morgan didn't tend to head a cast, so he's not even on the MGM lists, right?
We've seen some Frank Morgan headers.
Yeah, but it's pretty rare. Eleanor Parker, 2 stars, and we do see her in Mission to Moscow. Humphrey Bogart, 3 stars. Olivia de Havilland, 2 stars. Errol Flynn, 3 stars. Claude Rains, 2 stars. Ann Sheridan, 2 stars. Jane Wyman, 2 stars. Ronald Reagan, 1 star. And John Garfield, 3 stars. Now, since Mission to Moscow is a very hotly contested, debated movie, I think it'd be interesting to hear not only our usual suspect, Clive Hirschhorn, Warner Brothers story, but first let's hear what Leonard Maltin had to say in his 1991 movie guide. What would you think Maltin would have to say about Mission to Moscow?
Well, I'm assuming Maltin is not a communist, so I wouldn't expect him to be a fan, since the movie would be very offensive in those terms and doesn't have notable dramatic values.
He gives it 3.5 stars out of 4.
See, that's incredible to me. That's very eccentric.
He says, fascinating propaganda of real-life Ambassador Joseph Davies, played by Walter Huston, in then-peaceful Russia. Well done, giving interesting insights to American concepts of USSR at the time. Davies himself introduces the film.
The whole point of this movie is that these are not the American concepts of the USSR at the time.
They're the concepts being advocated by Joseph Davies and perhaps members of the Communist Party in the United States who were dwindling.
Some members? Not, definitely not all.
Well, the people who stayed by 1943, they would have definitely shared these opinions. All right, let's hear what Clive Hirschhorn had to say in the Warner Brothers story. One of the few films Jack Warner wished he had never made, Mission to Moscow, based on the book by former ambassador to Russia, Joseph E. Davies, was a blatant attempt to bully Americans into thinking that the Russians were trustworthy allies. Walter Huston played Davies. A brief prologue featured the real-life Davies vouchsafing the film's content as the truth as I saw it, who, during his 2-year stay in Moscow, befriended numerous Russian leaders, all of whom, he and the film claimed, were aware of the scourge of Nazism before anybody else saw it. The film's pro-Russian sentiments were reinforced by the ambassador's belief that Soviets and Americans were basically similar beings. The result was the most controversial film in the studio's history, attacked by its detractors actors for supporting the Russian regime and praised by others as a brave and necessary gesture in the fostering of a common understanding between the two great powers. As a piece of filmmaking, regardless of its political stance, it was, for the most part, well made and absorbing, directed by Michael Curtiz, whose unfailing cinematic eye was most notable in the big dramatic courtroom scenes during the Purge trials. An inordinately large cast included Anne Harding as Davy's wife, Eleanor Parker as his daughter, with resident quote-unquote foreigners, Vladimir Sokolov as the Soviet president, Oskar Homolka as Litvinov, and Manart Kippen as Stalin. Dudley Field Malone appeared as Churchill. Also helping to infuse life into Howard Koch's screenplay were George Tobias, Richard Travis, Helmut Dantin, Victor Franken, Jerome Cowan, Minor Watson, Maroni Olson, and Henry Daniel. The associate producer of this contentious offering was Robert Buckner.
So, the part about the movie bullying Americans into accepting the Soviet Union as an ally is kind of silly, because the book was a big hit. The book was a bestseller.
That's not a good review. Certainly not from a political perspective.
The movie, according to Wikipedia, lost money, but it had a budget of $1.5 million, so that could be why.
And looks it. It's a beautiful film. I mean, Michael Curtiz, he can't make a bad-looking film. He can't make a boring film, from my perspective, and this is not boring.
I expected this. All I knew about it was you told me that it was a pro-Stalinist film made in 1943. I expected this to be a propaganda film, and therefore to be kind of half hilarious and half boring. There were definitely hilarious elements in it, but I wasn't bored, because it is so detailed in the political points it's making, none of which I have the ability to evaluate, and idiosyncratic, these being the beliefs of Joseph E. Davies, his own idiosyncratic viewpoint, and he was there. He's the one who approached Warners to make this into a film, and he was there being David O. Selznick and really interfering annoyingly during the production.
Well, I read the beginning of the book, and it's all pretty much the same. There are a few little changes to the introduction, but what he says in his preamble is basically what he says in the preface to the book as well.
For that reason, I was not bored. I was fascinated, but I also didn't know what I was watching, because it is impossible to know. Like, in the film itself, Walter Huston, playing Joseph E. Davies, is saying that what he is saying is contentious. So how are you supposed to know how to evaluate this? My glancing familiarity with contemporary leftist discourse gave me the impression that it is nearly impossible to get an accurate perspective on the Soviet Union under Stalin. There is nobody writing about it who does not have an axe to grind.
Such are the vagaries of sectarian left politics, and certainly of right-wing politics as well.
So I assumed, coming away from this movie, that it would not exactly be easy to fact check it. I spent a few days, evenings.
We're recording later than normal this week because Elise really went down some rabbit holes.
I spent a few evenings looking things up on the internet, finding articles, listening to podcasts at work, and I came away with an even deeper feeling that it is impossible to be able to know what the truth is here. Some things are uncontestable regarding the purges that aren't gone into in this movie. Even the most dedicated pro-Stalinist revisionist I could find who has any kind of credibility, and of course that means 99% of scholars are saying he's a crank, by the name of Grover Fur, if you can believe it, who is an independent scholar who is actually a professor of medieval English literature. Even he doesn't contest the gulag numbers, the execution numbers, although when it comes to that, you have to talk about context and try to make comparisons to what other countries were doing, what other countries might be doing in a similar situation, etc., etc.
You mean whataboutism, Elise?
And not just point to the numbers and be like, horrible! And that's the end of the discussion. So he doesn't contest that, but the main topic of this movie, the Moscow trials, this is what is contested. And here we get into that factional leftism that you're talking about, right? Because it's the Trotskyites versus the Stalinists. Somebody is a very bad guy. One or the other of them is a very bad guy. You can't walk away saying everybody's good. It's okay. Everybody's a good guy here from the perspective of each faction.
From a perspective removed from that, you could say this is Game of Thrones stuff. This is Machiavellian power politics. People that opposed him had reasons to oppose him. They thought they could make something better of the Soviet Union.
Yeah, but what I'm talking about in terms of a very bad guy is that either these people were tortured, all of these people in the various trials were tortured into their confessions, framed by Stalin, making him a very bad, bad guy, or there actually was a conspiracy against Stalin by the Trotskyites that included potentially making a deal with Nazi Germany, making Trotsky a very bad, bad guy.
There are reasons for that. And of course, all you have to do is go back to World War One. It's basic Marxist revolutionary, certainly Leninist revolutionary doctrine that you can't take over a state unless it's collapsing under the pressure of war. The only reason the Soviet Union was born is because the Tsar foolishly entered World War One unprepared, got smashed by the Germans. The Germans funded Lenin, sent him into Russia to help him undermine the system, and he took their money. I'm not saying I know that Trotsky and his cabal, if they were a cabal, took up a similar deal from the Nazis, but they could have, and they could have done it for similar reasons. It doesn't make them Nazis. It makes them people who were following the basic doctrine of undermine and have the country be smashed from without, then take over and set up the state that you want. If they don't think they can win any other way, it's a reasonable strategy.
But gasp, how could they trust Hitler? Knowing very bad, bad guy, Hitler.
Yeah, but Stalin also made a deal with Hitler, as the movie shows us, right?
The whole idea of Nazi Germany was we're going to be imperialists, conquer the world, and set up our own way of life in it. So that's what I mean by I don't see how this would work out for Trotsky.
Well, I think they figured the Red Army would be destroyed by a German invasion, but the Germans wouldn't really be able to occupy all of Russia. That would overextend them. They would have to pull back, and then Trotsky and his people would set up a new state, a new Trotskyite state. That's a rationale I can see
right.
For why they would do it. It doesn't make them ideologically aligned with Hitler any more than Stalin making the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact aligned him with Hitler. It was something that he had to do, and the movie makes the best case for that anyway and says, look, United States, France, England, you guys said you were going to take care of keeping the peace in the world and in Europe. You're not doing anything? Well, I'm going to sign a non-aggression pact with Hitler until you figure it out. If everything alleged in the purge scenes in this movie is true, it's just saying that Trotsky made a deal with the Nazis and so did Stalin later, right?
Right. The movie does, however, want you to believe that Trotsky and his faction are very bad, bad guys.
Except that they're very noble at the end as they realize the errors of their ways.
Right? Which can only be accounted for by they were tortured into their confessions or they were just internally tortured the way that communists in their struggle sessions did internally torture themselves.
The most insane thing about the piece I just read to you from the Warner Brothers story is that Hirshhorn makes it sound like it's hogwash that the Soviets were the first to really understand the Nazi threat. That's stupid. Of course they were the first. The movie, you don't need the movie to convince you of that. They were right next to Germany throughout that period, and Hitler was talking nonstop about going and killing them as soon as he could. From 1923, as soon as he wrote Mein Kampf, that's what Mein Kampf is about. It's about going there and killing all the Slavs, taking their land. Yes, they understood the threat of Nazism much more forcefully than the UK or France or the United States did.
Well, yeah, the movie, I mean, many times they talk about the reasons, the practical, real politic reasons why England just doesn't care, why the United States thinks that they'll be fine. Got an ocean between us, as the Hicks say in their Hick voices.
It was really exactly what most governments in the West wanted. They wanted Hitler to attack the Soviet Union, have both of them fuck each other up, and then there'd be no more problem. That's what they were hoping for. It's not paranoia, that's really what they wanted, and they talked about it.
As I say, looking into the movie, fact-checking is virtually impossible. Better to just know what's at stake, what the various agendas for different stances are. You cannot trust anybody writing anything about Stalinist Soviet Union, even if they're saying that what they are after is the truth and nothing but the truth, and that's the only thing guiding them. They could still actually have an agenda, or they could not even know that they have an agenda. Case in point, the first thing I found was an article on the making of the film, published in a journal. This was on JSTOR, you know, the academic database, published in a journal called Politics and Film. Doesn't that sound legitimate and neutral? Peer-reviewed journal, article called A Great Historic Mistake, The Making of Mission to Moscow. But halfway through the article, I'm starting to feel like this article has a weird tone. It is much too excitable for an academic article of the kind I'm used to reading. It's frequently asserting you're an idiot if you think this, or you're an idiot if you don't believe this, without citing evidence. And there are a lot of exclamation points. So I thought I would look up the author to see if there might be an agenda here. The author is Ronald Radosh and his wife Alice Radosh. He is a former member of the Communist Party of the United States, who then became an activist in the New Left, and ultimately became a political conservative working for a conservative think tank.
So he's a Trotskyite who became an arch conservative. So many of those.
However, there is valuable production information in this article, so I will come back to it.
One thing I do want to talk about right from the beginning, it's useful for us to establish the ground that we're going to cover here. We agree, you, Elise, I, and the books we read, all agree this was propaganda.
Yes.
What is it propagandizing for? Not in favor of Bolshevism in America, right? What it's trying to do is making a case for the Soviet Union as a powerful state that will be a good ally against the Nazis.
Yes, but also, in order to make that case, it is asserting that this state is honorable and their experiment is honorable, even though we don't want it here because we are capitalists.
The emphasis is definitely on, is it functional? Is it going to hang together and be able to fight the Nazis and win?
True.
That's all Americans really cared about at the time, right? And that's what Joseph Davies cares about. That's what FDR sent him to Europe to find out about. One thing he mentions at the beginning of the book that's not in the movie, because I guess it would just be too complicated, is that actually his main mission was to go to Germany. Going to Russia was an afterthought. It's just that when he went to Germany, it was clear nothing going on in Germany except a lot of craziness. And when he went to the Soviet Union, he wound up staying there for quite a long time and learning a lot that was valuable for him to communicate to the American government. That's what everyone really wanted to know. And history did bear all of this out. Without the Soviet Union under Stalin, the Nazis win World War II. There's no question.
Right. But we don't want to downplay that so much of the movie is about making the Soviet Union palatable to Americans who have already heard a lot of alarmist things about the Soviet Union, including, well, particularly the purges. It was upsetting everybody, particularly the left.
And that's because Americans, and most people, I suppose, want to believe that their friends are complete heroes and good guys. Now, in the real world, that's not necessarily the case. And I don't know that you need to have the kind of faith in your allies that this movie, kind of encourages people to have.
Definitely wants to allay fears, sometimes going about it in extraordinary ways. The most hilarious moments of propaganda for me were when Joseph Davies realizes he's maybe being surveilled by the secret police. And he's like, you know what? That's great. I love being surveilled. I bet they're not doing it because they're such awesome people. And I bet they wouldn't do that to us, their American friends. But if they are, well, you know, good for them.
If you think you're being surveilled, that's how you want to talk in your bugged room, isn't it?
Part of a propaganda film. It's incredible. It's like, what an interesting choice to make, to just upfront take on those stories about the surveillance and the terror happening under Stalin and be like, actually, it's a good thing. It's probably not happening, but it's a good thing.
I think what it also gestures to is that every government was doing this. And I think anyone that's politically aware would understand that, right?
Well, the audience for this movie is not supposed to be politically aware.
But yeah, I'm sure they were being listened in on, and I'm sure the United States was listening in on everyone on their soil as well.
Of course. Would the United States actually have entertained an ambassador from the Soviet Union without surveilling them?
No, of course not. Of course not. We're living in the 1930s here. They've got the technology, and you better believe they were doing it.
So do you want to hear a little bit about the production then, Dave?
Sure.
So what the Radoshes have uncovered in this article, first of all, apparently there has been an enormous amount written about this movie, but their contribution is to have uncovered that the screenwriter Howard Koch was not simply blacklisted because of his involvement in this movie, that he himself was most likely at least a fellow traveler. Okay, I should define what that means. Someone who's not a member of the Communist Party but is completely sympathetic to it. And he brought on board as his technical advisor a man by the name of Jay Lida, who probably wasn't really serving as a technical advisor because he didn't, that It's not his specialty, and he didn't have the know-how. He had not recently been in the Soviet Union, but more of a political advisor. So he, fascinating person here, going off of his Wikipedia, he was an American avant-garde filmmaker and film historian noted for his work on U.S., Soviet, and Chinese cinema, as well as his documentary compilations on the day-to-day lives of Herman Melville and Emily Dickinson.
Oh, cool.
Traveled to the Soviet Union in 1933 to study filmmaking with Eisenstein. And when he returned to the United States in 1936, he became an assistant film curator at MoMA, and he was eventually let go because of his political beliefs. And he became, Dave, the central figure as an independent scholar, nothing but independent scholars in this episode, central figure in the Melville revival.
Yeah, it's true. I guess it does happen in the 1940s, right? And into the 50s.
Early Melville and Dickinson advocate.
Sounds like someone to look into.
And yes, and then became a film historian and knew a lot about Soviet film. And he was, yeah, very much a communist.
So one thing, just in case people listening, you may be even less familiar with sort of the history of the Communist Party in the United States than we are. We're not experts.
I don't know anything, Dave. Don't even include me in this sentence.
You do want to keep in mind the Communist Party in the 1930s was definitely taking orders from Moscow, as the senators would accuse everyone of doing, right? They were getting funding from the Comintern, which Stalin controlled. You know, they were at that time pushing the Popular Front, so communists would support New Deal initiatives in the United States. They would support leftist governments in France and other places. But there was a breaking point in the late 1930s when Stalin and Hitler signed their non-aggression pact. A lot of people at that point left the Communist Party in the United States. And from that point on, you have a real split between the people that remain loyal to it, that means still taking orders from the Comintern, right? Or the people who either just became conservatives eventually, or, you know, middle of the road liberals like Trilling and those kinds of people, or they started to create their own sort of Trotskyite entities.
Yeah, well, not Trilling, but some people did.
Right.
Well, like John Dewey and many of the intellectuals associated with the Dewey Commission that, although it had, wasn't a real commission, was not affiliated with the government, it purported to demonstrate that the Moscow trials were frame-ups.
And look, there's a lot of reasons. I can picture myself living at the time. I would never have joined the Communist Party because I just don't do stuff like that. I certainly would have been very interested in all of this.
You would have voted for it but not joined it?
I mean, there were other organizations, right? There was the Socialist Party of the United States, which had a longer pedigree. Eugene Debs' party, it still existed, right? These were non-revolutionary Marxists.
Wouldn't it matter, Dave, what class you were in?
Yeah, sure it would. Regardless, yeah, I think it makes sense to feel pretty queasy about the Communist Party, probably right along, because it is so centralized, right? And there's not really a lot of room. You have to follow the party line. That's the whole point of it.
Well, I'm fascinated by fellow travelers like Billy Wilder, who was not a Communist Party member, but was also never completely alienated from what was happening in the Soviet Union.
Right. Well, that's what I would have been like, too. You are interested in the Soviet Union and you want to see its project succeed, but you don't want to join a party where you can't really affect its decisions because the decisions are being sent to you, right? Support the New Deal. Okay, no, stop supporting the New Deal. I wouldn't want to be a member of that kind of organization, no matter how interested I was in their goal, because it doesn't allow much scope for individual thought, right? And that's not the point of it. It's supposed to be keeping people ready and organized to take advantage of whatever comes about to help the international communist movement. I understand why they wanted to organize it that way, but I just wouldn't have taken part.
There were also, though, as we uncover more and more through this film podcast, intellectuals and artists in Europe in particular who remained devoted to one version or another of communism, to do that without affecting their freedom of thought.
Yeah, sure, because you're interested in it without necessarily joining the party. Or if you do join the party,
there were lots of iterations.
But there was one in each country that was actually the official Comintern party. Right? And then there might be others that were taking positions against that. Now, the central bone of contention between Trotsky and Stalin, aside from the fact that they just didn't like each other very much, there were actual ideological differences. You know, they were both right there during the Russian Revolution. Although Trotsky was a Menshevik, but he came on board and was part of the original kind of Politburo. Lenin kept everything together. Unfortunately, Lenin got shot in the neck, started to have strokes after that, and then just died. There was a power struggle in the party, and there were differences of opinion. And Stalin was basically the prime exponent of the idea, when everything shook out, that what the Soviet Union had to do was hunker down and try the experiment of socialism within one country. Trotsky is more the internationalist, right? Like, the idea of taking over the Soviet Union was not to just try to bring socialism about there, because that wasn't going to be possible. And he's right about that.
It wasn't.
The only reason to have the Soviet Union and a Red Army is to use it against all the other countries in the world to try to bring about revolutions there. And Stalin was on board with that at the beginning, but when they failed to get things going in Germany, which was what everyone was hoping for, he's like, okay, well, it's not working. We've got Russia. Let's see what we can do here. We've got the Russian Empire, right? Because it includes all kinds of places that are not Russia.
Was Stalin not being realistic, though? Would communism in Russia even have gotten as far as it did if they had followed Trotsky's plan?
No, exactly. From a long historical perspective, which I think is the Joseph Davies perspective, right? If Trotsky had taken over in the 20s, let's say, and tried what he wanted to do, it would have been a very disorganized state that would have been run over by the Nazis. No question. What Stalin did was, through brutal methods that put a lot of pressure on the populace, and it wasn't fun to live through this.
Well, this is what I'm seeing this Grover person talk about. During the war, during World War II, when you're looking at the gulag numbers, you have to also look at the overall mortality rates in the Soviet Union, because people were dying of hunger and overwork.
The five-year plans to industrialize Russia and put it on a footing where it could actually compete with a modern industrial giant like Germany, that's the whole reason they did it, right? Because they knew they were right next to Germany, and it was going to rearm eventually and attack them. They knew it. Yeah, what he did, it worked. But yes, he became a hated monster, torturing his people into joining the mid-20th century ahead of schedule.
We would have hated that. We probably would have expired, like, fainting little petite bourgeoisie.
Yeah, so if I was in Russia at that time, if I was in the Ukraine or any other SSR, I'm sure I would have opposed Stalin, right?
And of course, Oscar,
with good reason.
Oscar Wilde and the Soul of Man under Socialism is all, I can get behind socialism, but not this version that's obsessed with work.
Right. But unfortunately, Lenin understood it. Everyone understood it. Russia was not a good candidate for a communist revolution because it wasn't ready. Everyone knew it wasn't ready. It hadn't had a bourgeois revolution yet. It wasn't...
Well, the same thing happened in China.
Exactly. Unfortunately, both of those places...
But they really needed to industrialize.
Yeah, so they forced that through.
So what would have happened, Dave? Oh my god, now we're just doing science fiction scenarios. What do you think would have happened if... Well, would there... I guess we can't even conceive of what a capitalist revolution would look like, because there wouldn't have been one.
Well, no, there were capitalist revolutions, but they just happened over longer spans of time, and they were brutal as well, which people just never acknowledge, right?
What do you mean, like industrialization in England?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was famously brutal.
The enclosure movement. I mean, all of that is basically collectivization in a different way, putting the power in the hands of gentry and nobles instead of the Soviet state, let's say, but people were thrown off the land in England, forced to go live in squalor in London in huge numbers.
Right, because urbanization was being hugely encouraged in the Soviet Union at the time.
Yeah, it's exactly the same. It's just was happening faster. Right?
Yeah, and that's
all it is.
A nightmare.
What he tried to do was, let's have the 18th century in England, but in 5 years. And he did it. The misery...
I mean, the movie is pointing to this and going like, how could any people do this?
Yeah, I don't know how they did it, but they did. The one thing that I think everyone needs to remember is that the misery concentrated into those years is no different from the misery that people endured in England and Germany and other places that industrialized over the course of centuries.
But this was being done for a reason, you're saying, for defense and for global competition purposes, not just for the purposes of enriching capitalists.
There's a different reason, but the goal is the same, increasing the material wealth of the society. And in England, all of that wealth went to rich people, and in Russia and Ukraine and everywhere else in the Soviet Union, it went to the state,
right,
and ultimately into the army, which is the only reason it was able to defend itself against a fascist state that also made everything subservient to the needs of the military.
Other than that... What is another thing that stood out for me in this movie, other than the issue of the trials? The other thing hugely emphasized by this movie, well, there's the issue of the trials, there's the issue of, you know, reassuring the United States that these purges were justified. There's the issue of reassuring the United States that this army can do what it needs to do to be a good ally.
And what no one else could do.
But the third thing that stood out for me is the emphasis on Soviet feminism.
Well, yeah.
And that fascinates me, because why is this part of Davy's propaganda? Why does he think that the United States, that men and women in the United States will be into this?
I think that's just genuinely ideological, right?
But he's not a communist.
No, but he is impressed by this.
Yeah, but he is impressed by it, but does he expect, well, as just to repeat myself, does he really expect the audience in the United States to be impressed by it? And were they? Because this book was a bestseller.
Yeah, well, let's not forget, in 1943, in the United States, women were working in factories in huge numbers because men were being drafted. This was something that would be recognizable on the home front as well in the United States.
We also see what you don't see so much of in Hollywood films at the time. Sometimes, but not so much of, which is women in, highly educated women in positions of authority, doing men's work, like the train engineer that we see when they first arrive, and women in the army.
Something that always impressed, you know, Comrade X.
Well, and Nanochka.
Yeah, every...
This new science fiction woman of the Soviet Union.
Every studio that made a movie about the Soviet Union during this period has to remark on that. I mean, it's an important aspect of the social landscape. Women were being asked to do basically the same things that men were being asked to do. Although you don't get any general secretaries of the Soviet Union who are women, so
now,
there's still ways to go there.
In case some people don't know about this, because this is not terribly emphasized when talking about Soviet Russia, the equality of men and women was part of the constitution of the USSR.
Yeah, of course.
The things that were initially done for women were astonishingly advanced and progressive.
It's no different in Mao's China, right?
No. Well, I don't know the details in Mao's China, but yes, the ideology was the same. But here, for example, again, I'm just taking this from a Wikipedia page, but to achieve the increase of women in the workforce, which of course wasn't just ideological, it was necessary for reasons that we've been talking about,
mm-hmm.
The new communist government issued the first family code in October 1918. The code separated marriage from the church, allowed a couple to choose a surname, gave illegitimate children the same rights as legitimate children, gave rights to maternal entitlements, health and safety protections at work, and provided women with the right to a divorce on extended grounds. In 1920, the Soviet government legalized abortion. In 1922, marital rape was made illegal in the Soviet Union. Do you know when marital rape was made illegal in the UK and the United States? In the 1990s.
Yeah,
like, this is insane! It is a science fiction world, what they were initially doing.
And they also took a lot of steps to prevent sexual harassment in the workplace, as far as I know, right? There were actual women's commissions on these things that were taking action when women were not being treated properly at work.
Now, unfortunately, according to this same page, by the mid-30s and continuing into the 1940s, much of this was repealed. It doesn't tell me why. A new conservative family values era set in.
I think a lot of it just met with massive resistance amongst the peasantry, especially.
Well, we shouldn't blame the peasantry, because I don't have any sources for that.
Anyone who was still clinging to the Orthodox Church views on these things, which was a lot of people, right? It's pretty hard to wipe out the indoctrination.
Patriarchy?
Exactly.
So you think Stalin was just appeasing the masses by repealing all of this? Abortion came back as soon as Stalin was gone.
I don't think this was because of any predilections of Stalin's, right?
Well,
I think it
yeah.
was political expediency. Although, I guess I don't know for
we
sure.
We don't know the details, that's all. But yeah, so this ideal was not maintained, but it was astonishing. I just wonder how much of this would have been left. The repealing started in the mid-30s. This mission to Moscow
in the mid-30s.
Yeah, from 1936 to 1938. I just don't have the historical details to know what feminism in Russia Russia would have really looked like to him at that particular time.
Yeah, well, I'm sure there were some steps back, unfortunately, but there would still have been much more scope for action in the public sphere for women in that iteration of the Soviet Union than you'd find anywhere else in the world, I would think.
Now, in the highest circles of the party, no, and that was apparently also true of Maoist China.
Yeah, I think that's true, unfortunately. We should talk a little bit more about the details of the film, some of the texture of it. I just found it tremendously enjoyable to watch. Walter Huston's always great company. It's sort of like Dodsworth learns about the Soviet Union.
It's silly in the way that propaganda is always silly.
Yeah, but it was really fun.
It's maybe best viewed as speculative fiction. I mean, it's one possible version of what happened, and also the Soviet Union itself at the time was like something out of science fiction.
You know, the greatest moment, the moment that everyone always talks about, it really does keep you guessing as you're watching the movie. Are we ever going to see Stalin? Is he just going to be like the Wizard of Oz? Nobody sees him, right? Because we meet all these other people, all these important Soviet officials, but...
And of course you're expecting him to be like Hitler, who's supposed to be like a mad dog foaming at the mouth. And he's just this...
He just wanders in.
lovely, benign, reasonable presence.
And he's like, oh, are you sure you have to go? Don't you have some time to chat, Mr. Davies? And Walter Huston's like, oh, really? You actually want to sit down and spend some quality time with me? Okay, let's do it. And they go and have this really pleasant chat about how, look, if you don't do something, I'm sorry, my friend, I'm going to have to make a deal with Hitler.
Hurry, go talk to Churchill.
Yeah, please, you know, get your act together on the other side of Germany, because time is running out over here. I don't want to do it.
Of course, Walter Huston is one of those leftists who was too big to blacklist.
Well, he died. Who knows what would have happened to him? Although John Huston made it, and he probably shouldn't have. So yeah, that talk with Stalin, just chef's kiss. It's so much fun. So unexpected the way they decide to play him, because as you say, he's so reasonable, really avuncular, earning the title of Uncle Joe.
Yeah, but you know, they didn't really over-egg it too much with the Uncle Joe stuff.
And they get this guy to play him who I've never seen before, don't know anything about him. He's not like a super charismatic actor. He's just a guy who happens to look like Stalin, who wanders in, has his little say, and then walks back out of the movie.
And then Walter Huston, when he signs the pact with Hitler afterwards, Walter Huston's just like, I knew it! We drove him to it!
Well, they did.
I knew it. I told you so.
That's absolutely true.
He's the Cassandra of Soviet-US relations, or Soviet-Allies relations.
Yeah. The talk with Churchill is pretty comical as well. I mean,
he's building a wall.
I just want to see if he's a good mason. The Churchill guy too, never seen him before. He just happens to look enough like Churchill that they throw him into the movie.
He's also very pleasant and reasonable. He's puttering.
He's like, look, nobody listens to me. I'm a reactionary. Well, why was nobody listening to Churchill? It's because all he did in the 1930s was talk about crushing India. Don't let them get out of our grasp. That's why the Conservative Party said, you're insane. We don't want to have anything to do with you because you're a mad racist, even to us who are racists. That's Churchill. But yes, his virtue from the perspective of this film and from the perspective of the New Deal government is he's willing to fight the Nazis and nobody else in England is ready to do it in the 30s. So he becomes a heroic figure simply because he's ready to oppose the Nazis. And again, that's why it's so wonderfully poetic that this movie brings together Stalin and Churchill. The only virtues these guys have from the perspective of a humane leftist in the United States in 1943 is that they're willing to fight fascism. That's it. Other than that, there are big problems with Churchill and there are big problems with Stalin.
Back to this film's reception and this article. According to the Radoshes, after the film's premiere, it became a battleground between the pro-communist Popular Front left, the small but vocal anti-communist left, as well as, you know, various other factions. There was a fierce public debate, and this produced a backlash in Hollywood. So the thesis, although it doesn't arrive until the end of the article, the thesis of this article is that this movie was the tipping point where the conservatives in Hollywood would no longer put up with the Popular Front. This was a bridge too far, Stalinist propaganda. Sam Wood was particularly set off. Sam Wood, famous to this podcast for directing The Great King's Row, and also by, according to legend, having been killed by our acturist, Margaret Sullivan, because she was defending some cast or crew member, a writer, I think, who had leftist politics against Sam Wood, and Sam just couldn't take it.
He went apoplectic.
And he had a heart attack and died. But before that...
Well, this movie, I'm sure, did some damage to his cardiovascular system as well.
Before that, but not as much as Margaret Sullivan. He helped form one of the first conservative anti-communist groups in the film Capital, the Motion Picture Alliance for the Preservation of American Ideals. This article insultingly and inaccurately calls him a minor director at MGM in the 1930s.
No, he's a great director. He just got terrible politics.
And this article thinks he's a right-wing extremist, so that's saying something. A man anxious to tar FDR with the brush of communism. I guess the Radoshes like FDR and don't think he's a communist at all. And then ultimately, this resulted in the creation of the Motion Picture Alliance. Anyway, the idea is that this movie leads directly to HUAC.
Yeah, well, I think that's a defensible statement.
Do you think Jack Warner meant to do that? Did he know what he was doing with this movie?
What Jack Warner wanted to do was support an initiative of the New Deal government. Warner was a big FDR supporter, and we know...
No other studio would have made this movie, though.
Well, I don't think so, although we're going to see. You've got Song of Russia coming up, not made at Warner Brothers. It doesn't have Stalin, but it's certainly a celebration of the Russian people, and I 1944 and their heroic defense of the world against the Nazis.
Yeah, but was it whitewashing Stalin? I think that was the issue with this movie.
Well, wait until you see Song of Russia. Okay. We'll see what you think. This is not unique in film culture at the time. Wait until you see The Demi Paradise, movie I love. We've got it on the schedule for a year or two from now in my Accents on Olivier series, where Laurence Olivier plays a Russian engineer and he's visiting the United Kingdom to help work on a new propeller design. And it's all about people in bucolic English settings becoming best friends with this committed Soviet engineer and everyone working together to save the world from fascism.
Do you feel like, because we've been talking as we go through the studios in the late 30s and particularly the early 40s, we've been talking about this Popular Front moment where a lot of leftist ideas could get into film because it was all subsumed under the heading of
smash the Nazis,
acceptable heading of anti-fascism. Do you think that all of those pro-Soviet films belong to the Popular Front, and do you agree with this thesis that it was that tipping point where people felt that they could, the Popular Front felt that they could unleash themselves, sort of, that did create this conservative backlash in Hollywood?
Yeah, absolutely. There's no question that these are the years when these things start to really happen. And the movies actually, as soon as the war is over and people are reassessing their relationship with the Soviet Union, all of a sudden, all of these movies look like the works of traitors. Yes, HUAC is right around the corner at that point. I mean, it already exists as the dies, but it becomes a much more powerful force in the late 1940s. And it's drawing its strength from the existence of movies like this. With FDR dead and the Democratic Party no longer really taking even much of a progressive line, I mean, everything starts to go to hell and people are very vulnerable on the left at that point. There's no one to defend them. When this movie's made, several conferences, Churchill, FDR, Stalin, just chilling out, talking about how they're going to save the world. Got along fairly well, or they seemed to, the united front there against fascism. And once that wasn't necessary anymore, yeah, everyone that had been part of building that narrative immediately became suspect.
That's one of the more poignant aspects of this movie, is the apparently passionate belief of Davies that the communists and the capitalists are going to be able to respect each other, tolerate each other, get along, live together peacefully after the war is over. Wouldn't that have been nice? Of course, it's not true then, because then we're imagining a scenario in which communism could spread to other countries by the democratic means of true freedom of speech.
Well, yeah, that might be a bridge too far. But I don't think we would have had the kind of tense Cold War standoff that we had if World War II had ended differently and the second half of the 40s had been guided by other hands, in the United States especially, because nothing else changed really in the Soviet Union. It's still Stalin. As soon as FDR dies, they know, okay, well, we're next on the list for the United States. We're just going to have to grab what we can. Now, again, I'm not defending what they did. They just clamped down on the whole of Eastern Europe. That's probably too much speculation.
I don't feel like there's that much to talk about in the movie as a movie. It's more what it spurs you to think about.
But tremendously enjoyable experience for me.
Very idiosyncratic.
Some propagandistic efforts really do come across as just sitting down at the table, not with Uncle Joe, but with, you know, Joseph Davies. And like, let's try to figure out exactly what you're trying to say to me, and how much do I buy out of this, and how much do I consider to be just expedient politicking. Once you've seen it that way, you know, you don't have to get angry at the movie for presenting this whitewashed version of the Purges. We know whatever happened there, Stalin did go overboard.
Really?
I don't have any doubt that there were real forces at work in the Soviet Union trying to undermine his regime, but I find it hard to believe anyone would question that he overreacted. As he said at the beginning, the whataboutism aspect of it is that if there was any regime or aspiring regime in the world at this time that had the chance to wipe out determined threats to their own legitimacy, they did it. Chiang Kai-shek killed every communist he could in China, every single one at a certain point, even though they were nominally allied and were supposed to be working together. He just did his own purge. He's like, okay, kill every communist in Shanghai. That's what they did.
Well, we all know that in the United States during the civil rights era, if any group such as...
Well, Black Panthers, all their leadership got wiped out.
The Black Panthers or the American Indian movement seemed like it might, in the distant future, become an actual threat to the American state. That was, you know, wiped out well in advance using any means possible, so...
Yeah, this is what regimes do. It's pretty horrifying.
Well, it was just like living, I'm sure, for the average citizen in the Soviet Union. We do get a sort of glimpse of this in Ninotchka. It was just like living in cancel culture, except instead of there being a remote possibility that you could be fired or have your career ruined, instead you could go to the gulag.
All right, let's move into Edge of Darkness. First, we'll hear from Clive Hirshhorn from the Warner Brothers story. The external problems surrounding the shooting of Edge of Darkness were hardly a help to the okay but only just product. Errol Flynn, the film's star, was in the midst of his rape scandal.
What?
Ann Sheridan, his co-star, had just parted from her husband George Brent, and a heavy fog halted location shooting in the Californian town of Monterey, causing an uneasy delay during which co-stars Judith Anderson and Ruth Gordon had to be restrained from leaving the film and returning to New York, where a stage production of The Three Sisters awaited them. But the fog and all the attendant problems lifted, and director Lewis Milestone was eventually able to complete the melodrama, which paid homage to the courage of a Norwegian fishing village and the brave men and women who brought about an anti-Nazi revolt led by Errol Flynn during the occupation. More timely than artistic, and coming at the end of a cycle of war films with a similar theme, Edge of Darkness was received with respect from the critics, most of whom acknowledged its good intentions, and praised director Milestone's fresh handling of familiar material. Robert Rossen wrote the screenplay from story by William Woods. Also in the cast, Walter Huston, Nancy Coleman, Helmut Dantine, John Beale, and Morris Karnofsky. The producer was Henry Blanke. Terrible review.
Sorry, but rape scandal? Was this a sleeping with a minor thing?
The statutory rape thing, yeah. It happened on his boat. Yeah, it was bad. I think that was a ridiculously poor assessment of the film. It's an incredibly beautiful film.
Based on what? What? Non-artistic. What kind of evaluation is it's not artistic?
Clive Hirshhorn falls down on the job here. Twice. This movie's incredible. This movie has nothing to do with a lot of the other war films coming out at the time. I remember first seeing this movie. It was on a double bill on PBS. They showed Desperate Journey with Errol Flynn and Ronald Reagan and Alan Hale just having a comedy festival behind enemy lines in Germany, just hamming it up and winning the war. This movie is just so magnificently stark. And Errol Flynn is giving the most restrained performance of his career here.
He's a pretty restrained guy in general. In fact, to the point of invisible underplaying sometimes.
When asked to do so, and here he really does. You know, he's not acting like Robin Hood here, or like he did in a lot of in Objective Burma or other war movies where he's just gung-ho.
Luckily, I haven't seen any of those. I tend to think of his performance in something like Dawn Patrol, which is very extremely restrained.
Yeah, well, he's a magnificent actor, and it's sometimes great great to have him be Robin Hood, right? But this movie wants him to subordinate his will to the collective because it's a socialist film written and directed by Robert Rossen and Lewis Milestone, who were both either communists or fellow travelers for sure, and they would collaborate on Strange Love of Martha Ivers, one of my very favorite movies, a couple years later. Yeah, I mean, this is not your normal war movie in any sense I can recognize. A very tense drama about people trying to plan to liberate themselves from the Nazi yoke. You know, Walter Huston is actually the central figure, and it's his dilemma that is given the most weight. And he's sort of the audience stand-in. He knows that getting rid of the Nazis is the right thing to do, but how do you go about it? What are the ethics involved trying to resist? And what are the pragmatic possibilities available to a group like this who are trying to fight back against armed captors?
I did not know that quisling was in fact a Norwegian word. It's used several times in this movie. Obviously, I've heard it.
Well, it was coined right at this time, right? Because Vidkun Quisling is the Norwegian politician who is most associated with just capitulating to the Nazis.
Yes, yeah, yeah. And of course, I've heard it in many other contexts. It became a general term for a collaborator.
Yeah, exactly. You know, we're in a very remote fishing village. We're far from Oslo, the capital, but we have some quislings in our midst. We have Charles Dingle, always a disgusting fat cat capitalist, and that's what he is here too. And of course, he's the one that goes along with the Nazis.
Yeah, from Little Foxes, which is right around this time.
Oh, he's such a creep always, and a great actor because he really makes you feel seething hatred for him. Hatred for his privilege and his inhumanity, always. And of course, we meet him. I mean, the movie is mostly in flashback. We start out in the cockpit of a Nazi patrol plane, and they see something amiss down in the village. They land and they see this scene of absolute carnage. Tell me what you think about this, but watching it this time, I've only seen it once before. I couldn't help thinking that this felt like the beginning of a Star Trek episode when these guys land and everyone's dead all over the place, and then this one guy runs out screaming crazily.
That's true. Although, other than the fact that these Nazis are very cavalier about the dead bodies, including the dead bodies of their own officers.
Well, true. Yeah, no, I mean, these are not the humane officers of the Enterprise, but just that setup, crazy scene, everyone dead. Well, you don't have to pay too many extras either. You just have some bodies. Bodies strewn all over the place.
These are a lot of bodies.
Well, I'm just thinking about from the Star Trek perspective. Yes, yes. Yeah. You have a lot of planets where it just seems like nobody's there, right? Or they're all dead conveniently. Then they walk into the headquarters of the Nazi garrison and they try to piece together what happened. Find the commandant of this little contingent of Nazis who's been shot in the head behind his desk, and they push him, they just throw him out of his chair. I mean, he's dead, no further use to the Führer. Then we flash back to how it all happened.
Well, he's dead. He's weak. He's a failure. Interesting role for Ann Sheridan. Always sullen, more sullen than ever in this movie, giving her own Ninotchka performance, her own version of a sort of stoic Soviet science fiction woman.
Yeah, she is the daughter of Walter Huston. She's a committed revolutionary. He's a vacillating bourgeois figure.
He's a real representative of the bourgeoisie.
That's right.
And he actually nearly destroys their mission at the end.
He basically does. It's just...
by acting like a... well, not... okay, no, we'll talk about that when we come to that moment.
It's Walter Huston and Ruth Gordon. These are our Ann Sheridan.
Very, very weird couple, especially as a couple of Norwegians.
Well, you do have to overlook that fact, yes, that
nobody's very Norwegian.
No, it's pretty hard to see any of these people as Norwegian, and the movie's not really trying that hard. The only people that talk with accents are people that are not Norwegian, right? Like Nancy Coleman is supposed to be Polish, so she has an accent, which right. I guess makes sense. I loved her character.
Yeah, yeah. The Nazis all have their cod German accents, of which sometimes turn out to be German and sound like cod German anyway. Now I'm just thinking of how many actors' accents I've made fun of, and then sometimes you tell me, no, that's actually their real
accent. They're actual Germans. Yeah. Yeah, but even they are probably putting on, you know, an evil Nazi accent, right? Because they're people who fled Germany because they did not agree with the regime. They're all anti-Nazis. They're happy to caricature Nazis, I'm sure.
But this movie has quite a humanist perspective on Nazis, interestingly enough.
Sure.
There is the German officer who is in love.
Yeah, it's a very touching little story that ends horribly. I mean, they kill him. He's in the way. He's a nice guy. He wants to marry her, but he's a Nazi and he follows orders, so they have to kill him in the blockhouse.
There's no attempt to either thoroughly demonize all of the officers or give any explanation for how they can be nice people and Nazis.
They're an occupying force, right? One of the most important roles, certainly, is the role played by John Beale. Wonderful actor. We know him on this podcast for his tremendous performance in The Little Minister. Here he is the Quisling, right? Ann Sheridan's brother.
Oh, I didn't. Now I recognize him, now that you say that. Yeah.
We definitely are not made to see him externally. We're meant to think about the problem that he has been mired in since the beginning of the Nazi invasion.
Although his sister has just, she really is kind of inhuman. She has no sympathy for him at
no.
all.
But she also didn't live through what he lived through. He was like a student in Oslo. He was there when the Nazis landed. There was not really much of a way to defeat them. Obviously, in Norway, all they could do was run away, the armed forces.
Well, movies like this always, usually they're movies about Nazi Germany. They always make me, or, you know, just Nazis in general, make me ask myself the question.
Would you be a collaborator?
Yeah, I have no idea. I really have no idea. I would say yes. At this point in my life, knowing myself, I'm almost 50, I know myself pretty well by now. When I was younger, I think I would have leaned more toward I'd be a revolutionary, and maybe it would have been true, because my life would have meant less to me. At this age, I lean toward I'd be a collaborator, but you also actually can't know.
No.
Until you're in the position of what you would do.
Think of it this way. I mean, we both disagree very strongly with the economic system that we live under, and yet we collaborate with
That's
it.
What I'm saying. Yeah. That's why my tendency is to say I'd be a collaborator, but when suddenly you're in a truly dire, unusual situation, everything becomes much starker. Who knows what I'd actually do?
You're always going to be asking yourself those questions most pointedly when you're forced to do something personally, not just compromise your principles, like, I don't believe I should be exploited, but I'm not really hurting anyone by doing that, except myself.
Or I don't believe I should buy things from Amazon, or etc.
Yeah, but if I'm told, well, I must report someone who's then going to be executed, that's when you start asking yourself, okay, am I just going to go down fighting and die too, or what's going to happen here?
And you can't know, unless you're actually put in the position. I don't think you can know.
No. And this movie does not make him seem like an inhuman monster for the decision he made, right?
It also depends on, as you're saying, it depends on your opportunities. If I was approached by handsome Errol Flynn to become part of the part of the revolutionary team, that would probably feel more plausible. And Sheridan says that to him at a certain point. It's actually wonderful that we got to meet and know each other this way through these circumstances.
Yeah, their love is born of this strange moment in Norway's history. Otherwise, they never would have come into contact, right? He was in the Norwegian army, which was defeated immediately, and he's just been hanging out there as a fisherman since then. That's why he's the leader, because he has military experience. He's not just a fisherman from their town. So he's kind of an X factor there, but he doesn't play himself as an X factor. I mean, he's really an integrated part of this movie. It's an ensemble film, not an Errol Flynn vehicle.
For sure. As I've done in the past, I managed to find a contemporary review on Curtiz Reviews, thanks to their website, of the novel by William Woods. They're always just little summaries, but they can give you some idea of changes made to the movies. And in this case, the daughter of the doctor betrays her father's devotion by giving herself to a German lad whose own hope is a future together in a peaceful German countryside.
Oh, wow.
So there's two romances with Germans in the novel. That definitely got very much changed, probably partly to create a love interest for Errol Flynn, and partly to make Ann Sheridan into Robert Rossen's ideal revolutionary female.
Well, she had been that in Juke Girl as well, of course.
Well, she gets a lot more action in this movie, though. She's an action female. Of course, that plotline seemingly gets turned into Ann Sheridan's rape, though.
It's a pretty stark, horrifying moment in the film. You see the guy watching her while he's goose-stepping around.
No one's allowed to say rape.
No, but there's no question about what happened, obviously. He kidnaps her from the church.
Yeah, people know the shorthand.
She comes back to the meeting. She's been missing for a couple of hours. She is in terrible shape.
That always rapey shot, weirdly pulpy, pornographic image of the legs getting dragged away.
Yeah, but here again, as you say, she is the paragon of the revolutionary human being. even outraged womanhood is not a reason to deviate from the plan.
Well, this is what I was going to say, that Walter Houston nearly screws up their plans, I was going to say, by acting like a human being, but he doesn't act like a human being.
No, he acts like a vengeful patriarch.
Exactly. He acts like a man who's responding to a wrinkle in the patriarchal code, right?
And Errol Flynn wants to do that as well, and Ann Sheridan has to set him straight.
Well, she throws some water in his face.
She does. It's an incredible scene. She's like, yes, they raped me. Now just sit down, and we're going to get them when we were supposed to get them. We're not going to go off half-cocked with no plan. But then her dad goes out and fucks everything up.
Because he's a weak bourgeoisie and he's never been fully committed.
No, and when he finally does commit, he commits in the wrong way and just throttles a Nazi in an alleyway rather than setting off the powder keg of revolution. The only reason they are saved is because the priest pulls out a Tommy gun and mows them all down.
That's an excellent moment. After he's just had his little conversation with God about thy will be done, I guess thy will includes, if my machine gun is not effective, then thy will be done.
That's right. The citizens are coming. You know, they've been armed by the British at this point, but they would have been too late to save all of the actors that we've been spending all this time with. They were all in a trench about to be shot by a firing squad. Only the priest saves them.
So two people are hanging out in the Nazi headquarters most of the movie. One of them,
The Quisling,
and the other one, this Polish woman who has been turned into a prostitute.
Yeah, Nancy Coleman, tremendous actress who never got a chance to really star in too many movies, but we've seen her, and she's got a great role in King's Row as well, as Louise Gordon.
Oh, that's right.
The daughter of Charles Coburn, sadistic surgeon.
The one who's going mad from her knowledge of what her father's doing, and also because she has the hots for Ronald Reagan and is sexually repressed. We first meet her when she encounters the shopkeeper, who has concerns about not being taken seriously by the other revolutionaries.
Well, we meet her before that because she's the one that sees this secret meeting between the undercover British agent and some of our protagonists, right? She sees them from the balcony and does not give them away, but she's hanging out with the Nazis. So we're like, oh, who's this person?
I guess I didn't notice that, but she does refer to it later.
But yes, when Roman Bonin, he's a blacklisted actor that I always love. He's the shopkeeper who, he's got some sort of wish to get involved in the glorious struggle, but no one takes him seriously. He has some sense of himself as a military tactician. And everyone just laughs at him, and his wife tells him to shut up a lot of the time, and he wants to just do something. And he is a buffoon, kind of, but a well-meaning buffoon, I guess. And he barges down to the Nazi headquarters and tries to enlist the aid of Nancy Coleman. Like, just tell us all about the movements of the Nazis so we can kill them. And she's like, you stupid old man, get out of here before they kill you. It's a great role for her. There are a lot of scope for different kinds of emotions, and she's in a really tough spot. I mean, she's not Norwegian. She has sympathy for anyone that's under the Nazi heel, but she's trying to save herself somehow. She doesn't want to undermine these people, but she's also not committed to their struggle. You know, she's got her own separate war going on with this commandant who is raping her every night, basically, and won't let her go home, even though he's promised her that he would, eventually.
Yes, he's good and creepy.
He really is.
But they are, I guess they are being portrayed, I mean, there's some master race rhetoric that becomes important toward the end in terms of how, well, this officer who's in charge, how he perceives himself, and also, well, it's mainly that, really, because how they're treated, for the most part, with some of them being very creepy, and the group at the headquarters being a bunch of rapist bullies, and the suppression tactics that they use on the people as things build to a boiling point. They are basically being treated like any occupying army.
He doesn't really talk a whole lot about Mein Kampf type stuff, right? He doesn't even want to be there. He wants to be in the thick of the real fighting. He's like, I've been left here to occupy this Norwegian village. Why?
He does make some references to the master race, and he taunts the Norwegians with that.
Yeah.
And then ultimately, of course, when he's writing his suicide note, he writes a little letter to his brother that he then crumples up, but he does say, well, I was wrong. We're not the master race if these villagers can defeat us. It was just a lot of talk. Like, he really seems to have believed that they were superheroes, that they were invulnerable.
Yeah.
No. I mean, that's the point, obviously, but it does also humanize him.
Yeah, and he does have a few moments, right, where he's like, why are you making me do this to you? When the school teacher comes and has his big moment, and he's like, stop talking this way, I'm gonna have to kill you if you don't stop, right? He doesn't seem to want to do it, but then he has to start smacking him in the face.
Right, the school teacher, so the school teacher is there being the representative of the bourgeois intellectual.
Who just has this ineffectual last stand, right? He's like, that's it. You can't take my house. I don't care what you do to me. You can't kill my unconquerable soul. And then he just starts getting slapped silly.
He actually also kind of finds out he's wrong.
Yeah, he does, but certainly a lovable figure, nevertheless, and admirable. But yeah, ineffectual. That's not going to change anything, what he does.
No, but not only that. I don't know, I really didn't know how to feel about how the movie is presenting his humanist values. Not the way The Mortal Storm is presenting them, Borzage is The Mortal Storm, where...
Oh yeah, the school teacher there gets... beaten.
Yeah, I guess it is similar. Those values prove as ineffectual in the face of Nazism as they do in this movie.
Yeah, but in The Mortal Storm, you know, the end game is just to ski away and not get killed, and it doesn't really work for Margaret Sullivan. In this movie, it's like, no, take back your town from the Nazis. You know, that's not even on the table in The Mortal Storm, because it's happening in Bavaria. So you're not going to beat the Nazis in Bavaria. You just have to run away.
In any case, I don't know how what the movie is thinking about this man's ideals, but the point is that the ideals give him the fuel to stand up to these Nazis, and whereupon they make a martyr of him.
Yeah, that's Morris Karnofsky, another blacklisted actor. Great actor. He plays Gershwin's dad in Rhapsody in Blue.
Really nothing like an old man getting beaten up for the pathos.
Oh man, it's horrible to see.
As I was watching it, I was like, it's not the same if an old woman was being beaten up somehow.
Well, it would be pretty terrible too, though.
It would, but this has its own kind of trope.
But we don't only have Ann Sheridan as a feminist superhero. I mean, we've got Judith Anderson. What a great role for her. I loved her in this movie. Hollywood often used her to play cold or mysteriously villainous women.
Right, and it is interesting in this case that she has a man completely infatuated with
her. Well, she's pretty cute. She's certainly not dressed up in a glamorous way. I mean, she is a hard-bitten revolutionary who runs an inn.
Well, this man has lost his wife.
Yeah.
This is the whole idea, that she bears an incredible resemblance to his wife.
Yeah, and I really like that scene where she sneaks up on Errol Flynn and Ann Sheridan and then gives them a lecture and then breaks down afterwards. They all get a chance to be human for a moment before the coming onslaught.
So communists are supposed to be anti-nationalist. How do you think Robert Rossen is feeling, or is he just trying to tell this story and isn't really caring about the politics of nationalism?
You do. I mean, at least you see some stirrings of that, like the kind of sympathy between the Polish woman and these Norwegians. Everyone that is suffering under the Nazi yoke, they can form common cause to some extent anyway. Yes.
And you do see Judith Anderson's character at least yearning to be able to transcend these differences, but you can't really do that when you've got an occupying force in your town.
It's not that he's a German, it's that he's a German who has taken over her town, as you say. Yes, that's the problem there. She doesn't hate all Germans, or presumably she didn't before the war started anyway.
It is nationalism that allows these people to tap into something that unifies them enough to become this effective fighting force.
Yeah.
They have to feel that they are fighting for something.
Yeah, well, that's Popular Front ideology at work as well, right? Like, you use whatever you need to weld the people together.
And you see that most of all, but maybe, again, I wasn't sure what perspective the movie was taking on the shopkeeper. Who's that actor again?
Roman Bonin?
Yeah, Roman Bonin. When he finally stands up to the Nazis and, right before he dies, gets to assert that the Norwegians are giants. But I don't know if that was supposed to be a pathos moment where you're supposed to really feel for him that he gets a chance to express this, or if it's kind of not so much pathos as pathetic.
I think it's both, right? Yeah, as you say, it's like, it's kind of sad that he sees the world in these terms. But for him, it is a great moment. But I think for us, we're like sad that this guy who doesn't seem to be, you know, he seems like a good guy, but deluded, and he dies in his delusion that this is about proving the greatness of Norwegians rather than overthrowing fascism.
Yeah, I really feel like the movie has those nuances. And of course, Lewis Milestone wouldn't be much of a nationalist either, having criticized German nationalism during World War I. So I feel like like the movie does have those nuances in it. I'm not just projecting them.
No, this is a very subtle war film. I don't know if I've ever seen a more subtle war film. With the stakes so high and with the ultimate outcome, this massacre, to get as much deep thought into the film as it does is quite an achievement that Clive Hirschhorn seems to have totally ignored. And the camera work is ridiculously beautiful in this movie, too. All those shots of the water. And I really like, too, how they introduce all the characters. You've got the undercover British agent who's pretending to be a Nazi and just dropped in to keep an eye on him for the Führer. And there was no warning because that's how the Führer likes it. And he's like, so tell me about all the troublemakers in the town. And that's how we're introduced to everyone, right? We have this model of the town. And the captain just points at all the different little houses in the village where the potential revolutionaries live. And then we look in on them in their natural environment.
Of course, the movie just keeps building and building in its tension. By Errol Flynn going and ringing the church bell, they manage to keep the villagers from turning into a mob prematurely after they see this school teacher being dragged through the street. Walter Houston just fucks it all up, getting this rape revenge, and they're all captured. And then it really feels like they're done for. It is nice that Errol Flynn and Ann Sheridan forgive him for killing them all and completely defeating their entire mission.
Well, what's the point in blame when you're all in front of a firing squad? You know, preserve those bonds of friendship.
But then it just turns out that the villagers have found the store of arms?
Well, no, the villagers had the weapons, but they were just waiting for the best moment to do it. And it just turned out that this wound up working. Go off on a tangent that happens to lead to the right resolution for the town. As you say, I mean, the movie manages to work in all of these pitfalls. You know, when you're trying to maintain revolutionary discipline, it's not easy. You have to ignore decades of indoctrination in a totally different moral system that is hard to shake off.
Right. When women are raped or old men are publicly beaten and humiliated, you want to take action.
That's right. And no, you have to wait for that moment when the Tsar's government has fallen and the army is in open revolt and then the Bolsheviks take over. I mean, that's the plan, right? That's what you have to do. You don't just do it because you feel like making a statement. You do it when it can do some good.
And of course, the Nazis are also trying to provoke them to take premature action.
The commandant would probably be happy to just kill them all and then he could get a different job somewhere else. Presumably they need some people running the town, right? The cannery, they are shipping food to the army. Also, they need to have a presence in northern Norway because otherwise the British are just going to land troops up there and start D-Day in Scandinavia.
If they're going to occupy a country, don't they need people to occupy? The old question of, doesn't the ruler need somebody to rule and that's why he doesn't just kill everybody?
Yeah, that's what it is, right? They need to keep the goods flowing to the metropole. All this canned herring, he can send it with his troops to Russia when they're invading Stalingrad, right?
Right, and if you're going to kill like a few people and only keep the people you need, you're going to run the risk of antagonizing the populace too much.
Yeah, it's a very delicate balance. No matter how psychotically ubermenschish the occupiers are, if they need something materially out of the situation, they've got to walk that fine line.
And yeah, they don't just want to move in and inhabit the buildings.
No, there's no point in that.
So we find acts of sabotage happening in this movie too.
Yeah, but this time for the good. Right? Putting kerosene in the fish so that Nazi soldiers get a pretty nasty surprise with their breakfast. So yeah, I mean, we've seen the two sides of sabotage.
The next really tense sequence for me was when the revolutionaries are bearing down on the headquarters and they don't know that the machine guns hiding in wait for them.
It's pretty awful tension, yeah.
And you know that John Beale and Nancy Coleman aren't happy with the situation. And somebody's going to end up warning them, right? But John Beale takes so long about it. I thought it was a great tense sequence. Because you know the outcome is going to be that he's going to sacrifice himself and warn them.
Yeah.
But they really draw it out, and then even after he does, nobody believes him.
Yeah, and they've got reason to doubt him, right? I mean, he's been living in that hotel with the Nazis the whole time, and he did some quisling stuff in Oslo, whatever that was.
And again, just as when they're digging their own graves and about to be executed, it really feels like this is it. They're just going to be defeated. They're just going to be destroyed. It will all come to nothing. I don't know if this is good or bad screenwriting, because I am just so... Maybe many people would think this was all too obvious, but I am just so susceptible to this kind of tension building.
Obviously, we know the outcome.
But of course,
because right? It's a flashback.
So. Well, we don't, though. We think everybody's... Well, we don't think everybody is dead, but they make it look at the beginning like everybody is dead, that both sides just slaughtered each other and there's nobody left. So we don't quite know the outcome.
Well, we don't, but we know that obviously someone got through that machine gun barrage and killed everyone in the hotel.
That's true.
So it's not about that. It's really about exploring the state of mind of John Beale, especially. And yeah, he makes that decision, goes out in redemptive style. And he really has to go the whole way. He has to jump out the window. The only way they'll believe him is if he gets shot, right? Really. That's yep. The only thing, because if he just stands there and yells, he could still be doing the bidding of his Nazi masters. If they shoot him, then probably he wasn't working with them.
I could see myself doing this if, like, there were very clear, visible stakes. They were immediate.
My sister's out there. My dad's out there.
Yeah, they were immediate. My action's going to make or break it. I am feeling so much guilt. I don't want to live anyway. And also, it's going to be a really quick death. I could see myself doing this. Yeah, you really do get into his subjectivity.
And Nancy Coleman, basically, she gets shot for daring to tell all of these Nazis that they're weak, they're gonna lose. Everything they've been telling themselves is a lie.
Well,
and she's obviously correct.
She's like the shopkeeper. She gets her little moment of triumph of just getting to tell them off.
You're just a bunch of scared little boys.
Yeah, but that does actually seem to lead to...
It has an effect on their morale.
It does actually seem to lead to head Nazi officer's gradual changing of his point of view about the master race.
Sure, yeah. These are all things that flash before his eyes right at the end. Nancy Coleman's judgment upon him, and the fact that they can't beat these Norwegian fishermen and women doesn't bode well for the Reich.
And of course, we still have it's 1943, the war is not over, so these...
2 more years to go.
These depictions of how the master race can be defeated after all, even by ordinary people, are necessary parts of wartime propaganda.
All right, well, I think that was a pretty impressive double feature from Warner Brothers. Next week, we're back to Dorothy McGuire, the actress of Revue. We'll be talking about Trial, which is a movie I've never seen, and Friendly Persuasion, one of her very great roles. Wonderful William Wyler movie. Looking forward to talking about that.